about anything else.
We don't want to know.
We're dedicated, yes,
to our favorite shows.
All my circuits.
Everybody loves Hypnotoad.
Scary Dog.
Larson at Blurnsville.
Futurama.
Good evening. You are listening to a Rattlegion Broadcasting premiere podcast TV party tonight. I'm your host, the mandated reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Rattledge. And tonight, our favorite show is WWE NXT TakeOver Portland, brought to you by the good people at the WWE, the Performance Center, the NXT brand, and the Moda Center, of which it took place in Portland, Oregon. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to announce that the Podsmen ride again! Yeehaw! First, Chris Bailey of the Super Blog Team Up. How do you do? How do you do? How do you do?
Someone told me there's a Portman Potter here tonight. That's woo. Yes, so we're here for WWE. Eat shit. Oh, wait a second. It's NXT Portland. Wait. Okay, I got confused for a second. I'm up here on Ice
Change
Planet
Hoth.
Change
the notes, yeah.
Here live from Ice Planet Hoth in St. John's, Newfoundland. We're ready to rock and roll, baby. Yeah.
Broadcasting live from inside his dead tauntaun.
It's warm in there.
At least until we can get the shelter built. And speaking of which, our other podsmen on this wrestling journey, ladies and gentlemen, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday. Chris Sheehan, how do you do, sir?
Hey, I don't know what a tauntaun is, so I got that going.
Oh, man, but, here we go again.
But it's not an ice planet where I'm at. It's kind of a dusty desert landscape here, and it's already warm, so that kind of sucks.
I want to put you and Robert Winfrey in a game show where you have where it's a contest to see who knows the least culture.
You know, I am a failure at most things, so I'd probably lose that, but I'd lose it by winning. So there you go.
If you know one black culture thing more than he does, though, you'll win. And that's tough because he almost knows. Because anytime I mention rap or anything having to do with black folks, black television, black stories, nothing. I might as well be. The only other thing he might know less than that is 90s music, and I don't know. I don't even think he
does
knows.
Does he call it the rap?
The hip hop.
The hip hop. Hey kids, do you want to listen to the Nickelback?
I think he refers to it as the hippity hop.
Oh no.
But yes, enough about all the culture that we don't know. We're talking wrestling tonight, our favorite brand, NXT. They had their own standalone show, nothing to anchor this one, no Survivor Series, no SummerSlam, no WrestleMania. This one was just out there with its balls hanging out.
Freely dangling.
Did it succeed? We'll find out over the next hour. Chris Bailey, what did you think? What were your thoughts going into the show? What were you anticipating? What were you hoping for?
I was hoping for a standard fair NXT show, which is never really a letdown. And, you know, NXT has a formula. Basically, it's kicking out of every single finisher and having a 5 out of 5-star match at the Tokyo Dome, basically what you can expect from NXT. But you know what? They put on a really good show. And Poppy performed.
If that's what you want to call it, sure.
Yes, that's what happened.
Yes, instruments were played. A gal sang. You know, Jesse and
Well, you introduced her on Metal Hammer of Doom to me, so I was somewhat excited. I'm like, I know her. I felt culturally aware.
That's right. You were down with the kids. You were.
I was. I was hip with the children.
Did Poppy make you bop? Was it a bop for you? That's the kids say.
Yes, it was. It was all just like the kids. I was bopping here in Hoth.
You know what though, you're not into like the big metal that I'm into, like the really really heavy stuff. So Poppy might have actually been your speed. Personally, having heard the whole album, there was heavier stuff on there. I would have preferred her to open the show with. This is kind of a drag for me. Chris Sheehan, what were your expectations, and what did you think of the Poppy?
I've only heard of Poppy, like there are some like YouTube horror channels that talk about like like that she was like manufactured and like there's like satanic Illuminati bullshit in there. I don't know anything about any of it, but I didn't hate it. I'm more of like a yacht rock kind of guy. I don't like it as heavy, so this was heavy for me, and it was okay. But as for the show, I was very interested since there is no anchor for the show, so it's kind of like sort of going without a net, and I had high expectations for them really really bringing it, because you know there's no other show to beat, so it's not like they're competing with themselves this week, but I think this was a real good opportunity for them to shine.
We opened up our show with our new North American champion, Big Keith Lee, basking his glory, and Dominik Dijakovic. Now, let me say a couple of things here. I like Dominik Dijakovic. I like his luck. You know, I like that he's a big man who's fairly agile. I like Keith Lee. I think he has a lot of presence. He certainly meets the big man criteria. This was kind of a Godzilla versus King Kong setup match for me. You know who I'm not a fan of, though? Kobe Bryant. And when he came out in this stupid sweatshirt...
I've got some bad news. Or good news.
Uh-oh. Oh, no.
There's a little bit of the culture I do know. Yes.
I don't know these people. I don't know these people.
Look, it's a tragedy what happened to him and everybody else that was on that helicopter, and that needs to be acknowledged. That's where the conversation I felt should have ended. It went a lot further without acknowledging some other unsavory things, and that's where I kind of landed with him. And I just kind of wanted to get past that little bit of ickiness. And then here comes Dominik Dijakovic in the damn sweatshirt, and we were already off in a not great direction for me with this match.
Fair enough. This was one of those matches where I've seen it 9 billion times. So it always feels when these two get in the ring that it's going to be Cena versus Orton all over again. You know what I'm talking about. It's that level of disgust in your gut when you got to see those guys on the like top up a pay-per-view again. You're like, Jesus, Cena versus Orton again? Come on. And then you got Keith Lee and Dominik Dijakovic. I mean, these two have wrestled forever, and guess what, every single time they win me over, so there you go.
Yeah, I'm with you in the sense that we've seen this match 400 times in a row. I mean, you know, it's, I think the first 6 weeks of NXT this was like an every week thing. The other issue with it is while both guys can deliver in the ring, and here's the theme of this show for me. And I think there's a lot of people on the NXT brand and some people on the main roster that were bumped up well ahead of their their well ripening date. There are some people who I think are technically okay, technically sound, and certainly have a presence and know how to sell the gimmick, but still need to be led by a veteran. Like, there are people on the NXT brand especially who I think would benefit from a long program with somebody who is stepping down from the main roster and has been a veteran for a while and really knows the finer points, like a Randy Orton, although I hate him, Edge, since he's back, one of the Hardys, you know, somebody who's been with the company for like over a decade.
Would have been the Goldust spot, probably.
Yeah.
Are you speaking of the former Matt Hardy who died on Raw?
Yeah, before they gave him brain damage. So there's any number of veterans who have been on the roster 10 plus years who I think need to be in NXT right now leading some of these younger guys, and that's where this match falls down for me. While it's okay, I think both of them are missing, and I'm going to say this again later with Rhea Ripley and Bianca Belair, both of them are missing the finer points of wrestling that take a decent 3-star match to the next level or two. And so while they pulled off some really fun maneuvers and there were some great spots, overall it was like these guys are capable of more, but not if they just keep working in the same box with the same people who are at the same level. You know what I mean?
I agree with everything you're saying. I love the match. I thought the match was a fantastic way to kick off the show, but I do see everything you're saying. And even with the presentation outside the ring, I think Keith Lee has, you know, charisma to spare. I think he's going to be huge when he gets wherever he's going. But his promos are very scripted. They feel very Reverend Devon, you know, like he's trying to enunciate everything and make his points, but really not sounding like a human. You know, he doesn't talk like a human being. And Dijakovic, his whole thing pointing to his eyes on his way out to the ring, that doesn't tell me, that doesn't give me any personality. It's just an idiot pointing to his eyes. But I thought the maneuvers were fantastic. I don't have the same AEW sort of fatigue you guys might have to the, you know, just the spot fests. So this was actually kind of refreshing to me. Just these just huge moves, ridiculous flips over the top to the outside, and all these just like Godzilla King Kong things, like you said. But yeah, I definitely agree with you that they're in like a, they're not in the gear they need to be to get to the next level. I think that they are just kind of sputtering with each other and at that same level as a lot of the NXT mid-card, where they're, you know, I don't know what their level of experience is before NXT. I don't know where they came from. I don't pay any attention to the alphabet soup out there of wrestling organizations that aren't, you know, the big ones. So I don't know where these guys came from, if they came from anywhere at all. But your point is that very well taken. They need to break out of that box a bit before they can really, really succeed.
I want to give Bailey the last word here because we were all kind of talking over each other. I know we had one more point to make, but Dijakovic came from Ring of Honor. Keith Lee, at the very least, came from Pro Wrestling Guerrilla and Ring of Honor and Evolve. So there you go.
So Dijakovic, let me speak on this, people. So you have Keith Lee who can manage to pull off a reasonable match with anybody. Dominic Dijakovic cannot. He manages to scrape together a fantastic match with Keith Lee. In Ring of Honor, this guy was a absolute cluster mess. He was botching moves all over the place. Dominic is actually incredible because I have not seen him in a good match outside of the framework with Keith Lee. It's like, okay, you guys are partnered together. It's the Bayley-Sasha syndrome. So, you know, those guys never really had like a breakout match until they had that match on NXT and everybody was raving about them. They pull them up the main roster and they start splitting them off with the other girls and they can't have that same type of match. And that's a similar thing we got here. Keith Lee's gimmick, you said that he sounds like a robot. He's just, you know, his promos aren't good. The whole bask in the glory thing, that gimmick just doesn't work for him. It doesn't suit him. It doesn't work. He sounds like Charlotte on the mic. You talk about someone who doesn't sound human. Charlotte is like, I am the queen. I am a robot. Please plug me in at the end of the night. It's the same thing with Keith Lee right now. So he hasn't found that ground or that connection with the fans where, you know, he's got that breakout star. There's something there. There's definitely something there. I mean, sure. He's got the personality. He's got he's got that beefy look to him. You know, there's something there. He's going to be huge. But right now, he's not making that connection with the promos. And the only other thing I'd like to point out was the crazy. Well, there's two spots in this match. There was one spot where Keith Lee was sat at ringside in one of the commentator's chairs, and Dijakovic did a springboard senton out of the ring onto the chair and missed, basically. He hit the edge of the chair and fell on his head. I was like, oh my God, there you go. Classic Dijakovic from a Ring of Honor right there. He almost murders himself in the match. And then he actually got me so excited that I actually stood up and was almost cheering for him when he did the Hulk up. You know what I'm talking about. So I think, I'm not sure what move Keith Lee did. I don't know if it was the Canadian Destroyer or what, but all of a sudden Dijakovic kicks out and he rolls right into the Hogan pump up, and I was like, man, yeah, this is good. And I was finally
he did like a sit out power bomb, but Dijakovic like rolled back on his shoulders and like got on his feet right away. That was pretty
so
awesome.
Good, man. Yep. Yeah, it was like there was real emotion in this match, and
for sure,
you know, for the 500 times we've seen it, it's amazing that they can still do it. But I think this is their curtain call. I think this is the end of their program, and I thought it was cool.
Yep. From a booking standpoint, from a need to sell tickets, from a wanting to hedge your bet, I can see the logic of one more Keith Lee, Dominic Dijakovic. Because you figure it's I like the Sasha Bailey comparison. You figure they've worked together enough for so long now that they should be able to pull a half passable match. Considering that this was the third longest match on the card, obviously there was a belief backstage of, okay, we've seen it 100 times. 101's not going to kill anybody. And people will pay to see this, and people will go home happy. And then let's split them apart for a while. Here's what I want to see going forward for Keith Lee. Kill cruiserweights. Kill the cruiserweights. Yep. Kill some British guys. I don't want to see him feud with anybody at this point until we get closer to Mania. And then, like, either feud him with...
Bow and Arrow guy?
Yeah, maybe Damian Priest.
No. Keep Damian Priest off my TV, please.
Well, they just got in Timothy Thatcher and Killer Cross. Maybe, you know, let's... I would almost like to see, you know, Keith Lee just kind of killing cruiserweights and British guys.
Yep. Absolutely.
From the UK brand. And then simultaneously have Killer Cross start working his way through people, and then, you know, build towards sort of, you know, an inevitable meeting at NXT where they've defeated everybody around them that isn't involved in another major feud, and but don't touch each other. That's been my big issue with WWE for over 10 years now, is because they have so much TV time to fill. People feuding touch each other way too much.
They're in tag matches against each other or teamed with each other. Yeah, there's no mystique to it anymore.
Wrestling each other. Yes, Chachi, Joni, the whole nine. They're wrestling each other every week. I don't know where they're going with Seth Rollins and Kevin Owens, but they've had 900 matches against each other. Yeah. If they're building towards WrestleMania, I don't know what there's going to be left by the time we get there. They wrestle each other every week. So, Killer Cross, Keith Lee, NXT Tampa, give it to me, hook it to my veins. Don't touch each other until until the NXT before Tampa, and have it be a schmoz, and I'll be happy.
Yes.
And
I think Angel Garza should beat him. I think Angel Garza should just beat him. That's my guy.
Okay, I'll talk to you later, there, Chris. And then let's get a veteran in there. Let's get somebody who, you know, I don't know, hook Dominik Dijakovic up with, like, Fandango or somebody.
Oh, God. Can you? Oh, no. Fashion police, Dominik Dijakovic.
Absolutely.
You can see him in some reflective sunglasses, right?
Yeah. Well, you know what? Eric Young's not doing anything, and Eric Young's a veteran. Put them two together. I mean, Eric Young's 5 feet tall. It's fine. Next, we go to my favorite match of the night. Honestly, I would have been satisfied had the show ended after this. This is a rare thing for me to say, because I'm always like, this could have been a little shorter. And definitely our first match could have been shorter by about 5 minutes. Dakota Kai, Tegan Nox is my favorite feud going right now. From right before Survivor to NXT War Games till now, this feud has been fantastic. I said it when we were off air. I love the deathmatch stuff. I love GCW, ICW New York, No Holds Barred. My son and I have been having just a grand old time lately, watching old and new deathmatches. And Dakota Kai came out in her deathmatch gear, with the cutoff shorts and the t-shirt.
Yeah,
you know, and her halfway goth makeup. These two, and Tegan Nox came out in pants that didn't fit. It was fantastic. These two fucking brutalized each other. They basically put on, like, the best you're going to get in terms of a brutal, hardcore death match in WWE. You know, you're not going to get fucking light tubes and gusset plates. You're just not. You'd be a crazy person to think that. But I think they got as far as this company is willing to let them go. Like, I don't, you know, again, you're not even going to get blood half the time. And if you do get blood, it's rare, and it's, you know, or it's an accident. So with those qualifiers aside, I thought these two fucking wrecked each other. Just, it was brutal. I bought that they hated each other. I liked their looks in this. They both changed up their gear instead of looking like the chick version of the Rockers.
hey.
I just thought it was great. I didn't want it to end. I could have gotten another 7 minutes out of this. My only issue was when Puerto Rican China came out. I was like, what? I didn't know who she was.
I thought she was Sonya Deville. When
yeah.
she first came out, I thought it was Sonya. I was like, oh, Sonya's down here. Yeah, but no, it's not.
Yeah, I didn't know who she was, and not that it matters, but she had kind of no look to her. She just wore typical random girl stuff. And I guess this is one of many chat. Like this, I can't imagine this is over yet between these two, and I'm interested to see where it goes next. I just wish we had had more of a definitive finish. But if they're like, no, wait till Tampa, we have more. Dakota Kai and Tegan Nox are going to throw each other off. You know, the fucking they're going to throw each other off the Bank of America building in downtown Tampa. I'm like, okay, I'll be patient. But again, for the 13 minutes this went before whoever she was came out, I loved this match. Bailey, why am I a crazy person?
Brother, you're right on the money with this. So, I mean, you were in a PG environment, and they managed to make this feel rated R. We're using just basic stunts, but I think you got the genesis or the all the building blocks of a proper way to do a feud. So one of the first things that's a big disconnect on TV, when you have certain people who enter into a feud and their first meeting they start with, you know, a wrist lock or locking up in the ring, or you know what I mean? These two girls are out for blood. They went right at each other. All the shots were hard. I mean, this wasn't Sid Justice hitting Hulk Hogan with a chair, man. These guys were swinging for the fence, ECW style, and it looked really good. I mean, they even broke out the laptop. Bang, old school, man. It was really, really liked it. I even liked the screwy finish. I don't think there's not enough anymore of introducing people out of nowhere, and I think that sort of worked. And, you know, remember back in the day when, you know, someone just – like China, for example. That's how she first appeared at Triple H's side. She came in, interfered all of a sudden. Who's that woman, my
well,
God?
Correction. She actually popped in from the crowd, and she grabbed China.
She ragdolled Marlena.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, exactly. But she came out of nowhere. You know what I mean? It was that's the type of thing you want, sure. And that's what we had here. Now, what was her name? Gonzalez? Was it Michelle or Raquel?
Raquel.
What's her name?
Raquel
Gonzalez. Yeah. So I mean, she looks like a monster. The only thing they really gave her something to do was when she shoved Knox off the rope or whatever. But either way, you know, the feud is far from over. But are we going to see like a Shawn Michaels Diesel type situation here now with Dakota Kai? I don't know. Dakota Kai, I got to tell you, like for the gimmick where she was just the, you know, the cutesy little nice girl in Team Kick and all that type of stuff, she's really upped her game. I buy everything that she does as the aggressive Tommy Dreamer of NXT. So yeah, I was all about this match, man. Really, really solid.
I have to say, just as a comparison, this is what they did with Dakota Kai is what they were trying to do with Bayley. But Dakota Kai gets it, or at least is given...
Yes.
More than Prozac Bailey. Go ahead, Sheehan.
No, I really, really love the way that they did this with Kai, especially since they brought her back, and her return just didn't feel like they. It's like they tried to make it seem like it was a bigger deal than it was, because like she came out and it was like people were like, "Oh, okay," and then she was like really, really sloppy because maybe they rushed her back. I don't know what the hell it was, but her turning heel was the best thing for her. Thought the match was a lot of fun. I saw these two actually. They were at the house show, NXT house show I was at a couple weeks ago, and just like Bailey said here, they didn't start with no stupid collar and elbow tie up. They ran in and tackled one another right before the bell even rang, and I think that's just such an easy thing that that WWE has forgotten about. Just showing real hatred and showing that there is more to a match than just winning a match. You know, there can be hate-fueled, you know, just being pissed off at one another, wanting to hurt each other, not just wanting to beat each other. And that's the feeling we got here, which we don't get anywhere near often enough. I mean, we're in a world where, like, you know, people can't run out to the ring without their music playing. You know, like if there's a bunch of heels on a babyface, no one's going to come out and save them until their damn music hits. That's how overproduced everything is here. But with this, it's just like they came out and they just started beating the crap out of one another. And I thought that was great. I think Knox needs to reconsider that weird corner senton thing she does. I don't see that ending well.
It's true.
Because first of all, it looks like shit. It doesn't. It looks like she's missing whatever it is she's trying. Even though we know what she's trying to do, it looks like shit. And it can't be. It can't be pleasant for either person involved. She's gonna clonk her head or something and just be on the shelf again. But thought the ending was really cool. I thought the table pump was pretty wicked. The table didn't break. It just fell over and.
Tegan Knox and Riho weigh about the same. These are slight women.
Yeah, and she looked like a corpse leaned up against that thing. It was pretty great. All in all, really, really good match. I'm trying to think if it's my favorite of the night. I don't even remember what the rest of the show is. I'll have to have you jog my memory as we work through this. But
Sheehan, do you know what a Riho is?
No.
She weighs 45 kilos.
she's Kenny Omega's pet project.
I thought it wasn't Riho like a cartoon bird or something. I thought maybe you were talking about that.
It's his Japanese mistress he has chained to the sink.
She likes to play with his Sega. Yes.
Is she a real person?
So two things here. She's a female Japanese wrestler.
Okay, so she's real. Okay.
Yeah, she's a real person. And
former AEW Women's Champion.
Oh my gosh. The other thing is, if you ever listen to the Jim Cornette drive-through, at the end of it, there's a guy that sent in a song submission that parodies La Bamba, and there's a line in there, and have you heard about Riho? She weighs 45 kilos, and she's their champion. She's a Japanese schoolgirl. I die every time I hear that. All the little girls like to play with Kenny Omega Sega. All right. The last thing on this, and it's something that Kevin Nash talked about back during the NWO days about, you know, and a lot of the old-timers sort of bring this up about the trick with wrestling isn't the moves and the matches as such. It's creating the illusion that what you're seeing might actually be real. And you do that with little things. The NWO wasn't a part of WCW. They were a rogue gang. So they would come through the crowd.
You know, sell their t-shirts in the parking lots.
Right, stuff
they,
like
they took
that.
Way out, yeah.
So WWE acts like everything is an Iron Maiden concert. It's just, if you've ever seen the Iron Maiden live, they're like, you know, or Kiss, they were known for their stage shows. It's all very elaborate, very staged, very, very, you know, high concept production. There was nothing really authentic about it. There was nothing gritty. And so, you know, things like attack, you know, you're in a blood feud with somebody and you attack them before the bell. That's an example of authenticity where obviously they're working a show, but it made it seem like they really hated each other. And so you can suspend your disbelief. If they had both just, you know, come out, you know, and as you said, circled and had a crisp tie-up, you're like, oh, I'm already out of this. But a lot of times, and the reason why I brought up, you know, how WWE tends to do things is they tend to not do stuff like that. They tend to do the big Iron Maiden production, and you're immediately taken out of the realness feeling of it. And I think that's why this was my favorite of the night, because this felt the most raw. You know, this felt the least like I was watching a staged production and the most like I was watching a fight. Speaking of which, Johnny Wrestling, Johnny Pinfall, Johnny Jobber.
Johnny I Don't Want.
Johnny Lunchpail was defeated by Prince Devitt, Finn Balor, in almost 30 minutes. And these two definitely had a wrestling match. I don't even know what to say about this one.
It was long.
Look, Johnny Gargano is a fine wrestler. He takes good bumps. He's a good underneath babyface. I think he's sort of defined by his struggles. That's like his whole gimmick is, look at me. I have no chance of ever winning anything in my life. But my wife is kind of hot. Eh?
No,
Johnny,
she's not.
Johnny, stop it.
Dollar store, Candace.
Johnny Gargano. You know, and if they're pushing towards like Gargano, Balor, Cole, and Ciampa as like a four-way in Tampa, fine. Again, you know, see my comments about Dakota Kai and Tegan Nox. Like, I can kind of accept this as chapter one. If that's not where this is headed, I don't really understand the point of this match other than they set this up a few months ago around War Games and they finally needed a payoff. Either way, Finn Balor beat him. Bailey.
I don't know where they're. I think this is it for this. I mean, I'm going to spoil the ending to the main event, but you know, I think it was just another person for Balor to tear through. I think the whole idea behind the whole Prince gimmick is that we're just getting a bunch of highlight clips of you know, Finn Balor beating everybody on his way to the NXT Championship again. So I think that's what this was just a placeholder to give Balor another win. Honestly, I don't really understand Gargano's spot right now. Like, is he staying in NXT? Is he going to the main roster? Because I tell you what, that kid is going to SmackDown wrestling Shorty G if he goes to the main roster. I'm telling you right now.
He's going to the main event to wrestle Eric Young. That's where he's going.
Because they really, really do not get Johnny Gargano in that main roster. So when he comes up, I guarantee you, give him 2 months and he's done for. I mean, there's almost nothing there. He's been reduced to a bit player in NXT. The only bit of life that he sparked in the last little while was rejoining DUI. Jesus, DIY. DUI, you could call it, absolutely. You know, there was a little spark going there. You finally thought, you know, there was a bit of life in Gargano, but nope, he's back to losing to Finn Balor here. What I will say about this match, like you said, it was definitely a wrestling match, tons of kickouts and all that type of stuff. I love the aggression from Balor. Since he's become the Prince, there's definitely a little bit of extra stink put on every single move he does, including the shit sling blade. You know, really, really good, and I love that finishing DDT. I know I say it every single time, but I don't know. There's something definitely different about Balor. I like where they're going with him, and minus the demon gimmick. The only thing that I will say, if anyone is familiar with Prince Devitt, he used to mix up his gimmicks, man. I think we're missing a bit of that. He would come out dressed as the Joker. He would come out doing a Spawn gimmick, you know what I mean? Like, he's done a lot of different things, so why don't we touch on that little aspect of the Prince? We haven't seen much of that, but Finn Balor gets the win here.
T-shirts with that, though.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, you can't really go into, you know, IPs right here on the WWE show, but I mean, this was about as, you know, as fine as you could get, Mark.
Yeah, I'm going to pitch it over to Sheehan. I mean, again, my interpretation of this, especially the way Cole versus Ciampa ends, is that there's going to be a four-way in Tampa. If there's not going to be a four-way in Tampa, I honestly have no idea what we're doing, but I'm a Gemini and I never know what to expect.
I think by you breathing it into the air and saying there's a four-way, you've just unveiled it to the universe. Now it's going to happen. I hate you.
By the way, to the one guy who just got my Kentucky Fried movie reference, you're welcome. Go ahead, Sheehan.
This was a very long match. it's so weird in my older age here. I used to be able to watch the long matches and just like be riveted. I mean, even like you know, Shawn Michaels, Bret Hart, the hour-long match. It was just I was able to do it. This was just like, okay, just end. But then again, that didn't have near as many 2.9 counts as this one did, where it just feels like, just like every Gargano match, it's like, okay, we're going to wheel the cannon out. Okay, let's get the noose. Okay, the flamethrower. We got to do something to hold this kid down. And finally, he did with the DDT. And like pretty much everything Bailey said, Balor is it's coming off so mean with every move he's got. It's great. Gargano, I don't know what's in the future for him. I don't see him being moved up to the main roster without Ciampa, and I think Ciampa already said he's never going to go. So I don't know I don't see him as a single star up there, at least not initially. But Here he is losing to Balor. I do think that this is just another match for Balor. This is just Balor working his way through the upper mid-card and main event circuit of NXT before, you know, reclaiming his title. So I don't know that this will necessarily lead to anything. I don't know that it necessarily won't. But, you know, I don't think there was ever any doubt that Balor was going to win this. And he did.
Rhea Ripley is every girl I wanted to date from 15 to about 30. I love her look. That's all the girls I've ever loved before. Bianca Belair. Bianca Belair, I had no interest in when I first saw her, but she won me over with her athleticism. She is amazing. I am a fan. Everything I said about Keith Lee and Dominic Dijakovic applies to these two. I'm kind of glad Rhea Ripley is getting to work with Charlotte going into WrestleMania, because she really needs to. She needs somebody to help fill in the gaps, because these two right now are capable of so much more, but they're stuck in this gear that they're in because all they ever do is work with the other gals at the same exact level or worse. So all of Rhea Ripley, and what I'm afraid is going to happen to Rhea Ripley, which again is why I'm glad that they're shifting her now over to Charlotte, is because for better or for worse, Charlotte knows what she's doing. And whether you love her or you hate her, and I'm not the world's biggest fan, though her promo on Raw was fantastic. Charlotte's been in the company long enough. Obviously, she's one of the favorites, and I do think she has some of that, you know, those veteran abilities that she can help somebody who's willing to listen and be open to criticism and new things and be willing to learn. So I hope Rhea Ripley makes the most out of working with Charlotte. Bianca Belair needs somebody like a Charlotte to work with as well. I don't know quite who is available on the roster that they could put her with going forward, but she's a future champion, and she's somebody who I think could be like a Titus O'Neil, you know, an ambassador that you can send into all these other the schools and whatnot, and I think she'd be great. But when it comes to having matches, and this is a classic example of it, it's just an okay match. They do stuff. It's mostly crisp. It's fine. It works. But it's never exalted or elevated to the point where it's great. And I think it's because neither one of them know what to do to get it there, and there's nobody around to drag them there, to get them there through working. So that's kind of my take on this match. This is what I was starting to say before. What I'm afraid of is that they're not going to do. Once Rhea Ripley's done with Charlotte, they're not going to do that, and Rhea Ripley's going to take the title off of her and go, well, it just didn't work out, brother. Like, she's going to get Ultimate Warriored. You know, where it's like, we tried. Well, now let's put it back on Charlotte. All right, she's not in NXT anymore, but, you know, there'll be somebody else that'll be like, well, it didn't work out with you. It's like, no. You just didn't give her the right opportunities. She's fine. Give this a chance. So I'm tentatively waiting to see how things go with these two, but they're great. This was just okay. Bailey?
Yeah, so, I mean, you talked about Rhea Ripley, and I know you're quite fond of her. To me, she's that girl that you wake up with in university, and you're spooning, and you get this nice little surprise in the butt, you know what I mean?
Be open to new things, Bailey.
Hey, listen, this is 2020, bro, where it's all good.
Who are you to kink shame, sir?
Anyway, Bianca Belair, there's definitely something there, man. Just her entrance coming through, she's WWE ready right out of the gate. And you're exactly right. It's another one of these situations where these two work well with each other, but they're caught at that level. You know what I mean? They're stuck in that groove where they can't lift them. And I think Charlotte is the answer to that. My question is, where does Bianca Belair fit in moving after this match? Is this leading to a three-way, a mixed match, or does Bianca go off and just do something else? Is this just another, you know, another notch in the bedpost for Rhea Ripley, you know what I mean? I don't know. But, either way, I mean, it was clear what was going to happen here. I fully expected Charlotte to show up. She did. She came off like a star. Those fans hated her guts after Ripley won and she attacked her and knocked her out. One thing that I will say about Charlotte is that natural selection move, that is one of the crappiest. Like, what is that? Just picture this. Okay, picture this. So you're lying down, you're lying on the carpet in your living room, and your son comes up and he flips over your head and softly puts your face in the mat. That would not hurt, or it's useless. It's like the Steiner recliner. It's a pointless move. It does nothing. So
I don't know about your son. My son likes to do the fucking last shot.
Oh my God.
You haven't lived until your 5-year old takes a running knee strike into your face.
Oh, listen, you know the Balor stomp off the top rope.
Sure.
That's what my kids did, except they had no concept of, you know, holding back, brother. It was full steam ahead.
leaning forward.
I was that dad doing the power bombs on my kids on the bed. You know, that was me.
Sheehan, should you ever be blessed enough to have children, just do yourself a favor for the first few years after they start to walk, wear a cup.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say we're actually working on that. So you never know.
As we speak?
Well, not exactly as we speak, but around the time.
Like, that's amazing. You can podcast and do that at the same time. You're my hero.
I'm a man of many talents. Yes.
I think I don't know. I'm pretty confident that Belair is going to be added to this match. I'm telling you right now. I'd be surprised as going into WrestleMania just to see Rhea Ripley and Charlotte. I may be completely off base here, but there's something tells me that that we haven't seen the last of Bianca at some point, whether she interferes or does something in this one. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I'm with you there, and I should have mentioned that before, that I think it's going to end up being a triple threat, because first of all, I think Bianca Belair could learn a lot working with Charlotte as well. And considering Charlotte attacked both of them, they both attacked Charlotte, they just had a match with each other, yeah. I can see this, kind of like with the four-way that I keep pitching, I can see that match actually being a triple threat.
I tell you one danger with the Bianca Belair character. You know, it started out as, you know, a pretty funny gimmick. You know, she had the big hair. She's, you know, she's too cool for school. But now, I think they're transitioning into an area where I don't think they need to go with this character, which is, you know, making black history patterned all over her attire. I'm not really sure that's the... You know, that's the angle they need to be going for. I'm not saying that, you know, wrestling doesn't need like a strong black woman character, but is Bianca Belair that person? I don't know. It just doesn't suit her gimmick. So I'm kind of skeptical that they're going to damage her gimmick by doing that. I mean,
no, I'm okay with it.
That's just I think that might be just a February thing as well.
It's a February thing. That's terrible.
It's when they start talking about Ernie Ladd. It's the only time they talk about Ernie Ladd all year.
It's February. That's awful. It's the one time we can talk about black folks in wrestling. Come on, let's get it done.
The damn shame. No, you got Ernie Ladd once a year.
I'd like to bring up the Junkyard Dog. Well, it's April 1st, so no.
Sorry. February. Yeah.
We're going to hell. That's it. This is our last show on the W2M Network. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having us.
I'm fine with it. I think there's a lot of young black gals who, to one degree or another, can project themselves onto Bianca Belair. And so, like, what do you want her to be? You fucking Malcolm X? I mean, she's not... You know, I think there's a lot about her that is appealing to not just black girls, but any girl. You know?
Absolutely.
And so if she wants to be, you know, I'm black and I'm proud. I'm, you know, black is beautiful. You know, 2020 style. I'm kind of fine with it, and I think it's fine. I don't know how else you do that without making it overly political. So,
Jess, I will caution this, Bianca. If you're listening to this match or this particular podcast, take a look at what Naomi looks like here in 2020. That is you in a few years if you go to the main roster. Steer clear, my friend.
Hey, listen, man, when she won the title in Orlando a couple of years ago at WrestleMania, man, that you know, the 20 people that were left.
I was there live, brother. I saw it.
Waiting for Roman Reigns to fucking wrestle The Undertaker, because I hightailed it the fuck out of there.
Me too. I thought I was the only one. I didn't want to bring it up on the podcast. Myself and my dad got the fuck out of there.
Yeah, whatever the match was before Naomi and whoever the hell she wrestled for the title, that's when I grabbed my wife and I'm like, I've got cancer. We got to go. And I don't want to watch Roman Reigns. Get me the fuck in the car. But yes, the people that who watched the match were very happy for her when she won the title that night. So, you know, Naomi's not done too bad for herself. Chris Sheehan, we've like talked all over you here. Rhea Ripley, Bianca Belair, give it to me.
I think I might have a dissenting voice here. I don't think they've got good chemistry. I think they're both. I think Bianca is phenomenal. I think she has a huge future ahead of her. I think Rhea will get there. She's a little sloppy, and her moves don't look terribly impactful. I think she's supposed to be like this, like sort of like the heavy of the match, you know. And that Riptide sucks, you know. That finish sucks. Yeah, really, it's not very good. I don't think the match was ever in question here. I think we knew that Rhea was going to win this, and I don't know if they'll do a triple threat. I don't know if maybe they'll have they'll do like a Bianca Charlotte like sidebar at whatever the hell the next show is. What do we have? We have a Elimination Chamber. Maybe they'll do something there. Maybe they'll do something at the other NXT the next takeover and do it there. I don't know if they'll do a triple threat, but I fear that like Bianca. It's almost like she's running a risk of becoming Bray Wyatt, where it's like they build her up, right? They keep building her up. They make her look credible. They make her look incredible, and she can't get the job done, you know. And I feel like they've done that several times just this past year, where it's like she is like the next one who's going to take the title, and she always comes up short. And I think it's just going to fall into that old WWE thing that by the time they actually let her win the big one, no one's going to care, which is just like par for the course for this company. But I didn't think they had very good chemistry. I think they've had better matches apart. I think, you know, throw Io Shirai in there, and I think they'll both have a better match with Io. But
she's crazy.
She is, and she's injured, unfortunately. So that probably won't be happening. But it was an okay match. It might have been my bottom match of the night, I just think they I just don't think they work well with each other yet.
The Broserweights beat the Undisputed Era of how much fish could Bobby Fish fry if Bobby Fish could fry fish.
No, Mark. There was something there with this Broserweight gimmick, man. But whatever was there, they just killed with that stupid.
The crowd.
Bobby Fish could fish fry fish. You fish. Oh my God! Continue on. I'm hurting.
The crowd enjoyed it. The crowd. Every college kid who was there in the Portland area thinks Matt Riddle is hilarious. So.
Oh man, I don't know. I think they struggled to get the crowd behind this. I mean, it came up on the stupid Videotron, man. They had the bouncing ball and the karaoke thing, and they wanted people to sing like how much fish could Bobby Fish fry if Bobby Fish could fry fish. It was brutal.
And Kyle O'Reilly.
Oh my God. Oh yeah, well, poor Broserweights. Those poor guys. I just felt so bad. Matt Riddle tried his level best to get that over, and there was no winning with that.
So the subtle art of tag team wrestling is, you know, you're working in tandem with your partner. You're just not taking turns in the ring like it's a fucking video game. You're doing tandem moves. You're taking advantage of the tag team rules. You're protecting your partner when he's in peril, hot tags, the whole nine yards. You know, if you go back to the Dudleys, Hardys, and Edge and Christian, and how they used to lay out those matches, they were, you know, more in recent history, just about anything with the Revival. That's the whole reason they were called the Revival, is that they were showing you what classic tag team wrestling is supposed to look like.
On Twitter.
Yes. And the Broserweights versus the Undisputed Era, I thought, come right out of, you know, the classic tag team match, Milou. I thought this was great. I'm glad it was only about 17 minutes. The Broserweights look like, they, you know, as wide as Pete Dunne is and as athletic as Matt Riddle is, I believed they were in peril against the Undisputed Era. there was a lot of near falls where it's hard to get over near falls now because everybody does them and they do 500 a match. But I really did think there were times where the Undisputed Era won the thing. And the Bruiserweights were able to utilize their strengths and weaknesses in their favor and overcome the Undisputed Era, who have been running roughshod over the tag team division over this past year. And they looked awesome. And then that picture, when Pete Dunne originally did the whole thing of coming out with the title in his mouth, I was like, well, that's the worst thing I've seen since Bubba Ray Dudley wearing it around his head. And something about it last night just clicked in my head for me, and now I want to do it. Like, I just want to be in a... I said on Twitter, like, when I finally get, God willing, the all clear from the doctors that I'm in remission again, and it's, you know, cancer's all the way gone, I want to stand in a ring with a belt in my mouth doing that pose. That just looks so cool to me. I don't know why, but... I enjoyed this match. Not as much as I enjoyed Dakota Kai versus Tegan Nox, but it was probably my second favorite match of the night. I thought it was great, Bailey.
Yeah, man. Listen, it took me a little while to get over like the picture of a cartoon fish with Bobby Fish's head on it singing along to the song at the beginning. So that took a little bit out of the match for me. But man, it was a full scale traditional tag team match, and it had the best of tag team work. But one thing that NXT does well is tag team wrestling. And this was just another showcase, man. I'm telling you right now, you got four guys in there who are like classic 80s NWA level tag team work. I mean, it was fantastic. Great tags in and out, lots of dual submissions. We had tons of stuff going on there. And the Bruiserweights actually winning the belt was a little bit of a surprise. I didn't think they were going to go all the way with them, but when looking back on it now, it was pretty clear that they were gonna go over. But I think you got a fun little team here. But I think down the road, it's one of those things where they're going to turn on each other, and you're going to have a full on feud going on there. But for right now, I really dig it. Really, really strong match. Nothing more really to say about that, except the stupid karaoke at the beginning almost killed it. But they won me over, by God, with great wrestling.
Well, then I have to ask Chris Sheehan. Does Pete Dunne or Matt Riddle go through the barbershop window?
Oh, I was gonna start by saying the place is gonna go nuts when Pete Dunne backstabs our Riddle.
Yes, sir.
That's gonna be huge.
Marty Jannetty's gonna be on the other side of the window, ready to catch him.
So that's gonna be really, really cool. Do you
I
think
wanna,
Kyle
hang on.
O'Reilly?
I want to see that now. When Matt Riddle goes through the barbershop window, I want the camera to pan around. And there's Matt Marty Jannetty reading a newspaper, going, "He kicked you through the window,
there.
He kicked you like the one guy at the end of that Ren and Stimpy cartoon where he's just like, you pissed on the electric fence, didn't you? He's like, he kicked you through the window, didn't he? All right, go ahead, Sheehan.
I was wondering here. I saw Kyle O'Reilly come out. Do you think he's ever held a guitar? Like, I don't know what he's like. He's like, it's like he's having sex with the belt, but like in an electric guitar sort of way. I don't know that he's ever held an actual guitar in his life, which makes it all the better. But just like you said, Mark, there were times where I figured that I thought the Undisputed Era was going to win. There was very, very high stakes towards the end. This is one match where the near falls really worked for me because I could have seen the match going either way. It's one of those things where you can't do that when it's a foregone conclusion. But a match like this where you have like a makeshift team that hasn't been teaming for a while, you don't know who's going to win. So it really worked for me here. I feel like I don't know what it is with Riddle lately. It feels like his character has turned from, like, you know, ass kicker who smokes pot to pot smoker who wrestles.
Yep, I agree.
It feels like they're really like kind of pushing that, and it's like, I mean, I remember like late 98 or whatever when RVD turned from the wrestler who smoked pot to the pot smoking wrestler, and everyone started adding 420 to their AOL screen names in honor of that. But I think they need to calibrate. I think on that to make him I don't want to say more PG, but just more normal dude instead of the
I say lean into it. Have your whole robe made of like big pot leaves.
Really?
your shorts made of hemp. Dread his hair and have him just come in his entrance, just have it all be
It's just smoke.
Yes. Yeah. All right. I'm gonna ask Sheen a question here, and then Bailey, I want to get your input on this. This came up in a private chat that I'm in with other we'll call them wrestling fans. They definitely used to watch wrestling. I'm not really sure what their issue is anymore.
Oh, I don't like them already.
Lapsed enthusiasts.
Yeah. This happened after the whole Matt Riddle, Brock Lesnar thing at the Royal Rumble. Now, the story is that Matt Riddle has been calling Brock Lesnar out on Twitter. Brock Lesnar cornered Matt Riddle backstage at the Royal Rumble, basically said, "Take my name out of your fucking mouth, you weirdo. We're never going to work together." And then Brock Lesnar fucked off. And Matt Riddle went, "Huh?" and just continued to smoke pot. Allegedly, management caught wind of it and punished Matt Riddle, which is why he was in the Royal Rumble for all of 30 seconds. Allegedly, that's how it was always going to go. Who the fuck knows? But it brought up an interesting kind of fantasy fight. What if Brock Lesnar fought Matt Riddle in a UFC fight? Who wins? Christian.
Ooh, wow. I was going to say in a wrestling match. That's one thing, but in an actual shoot fight?
If Brock Lesnar went back to the UFC and Matt Riddle just went in heavy and they fought at heavyweight, who do you think would win?
Riddle's got good strikes and Brock doesn't like to get hit. So I don't know. That's a tough one to call. I think maybe Riddle could take it.
That was my argument. I thought for the same reason that I think Matt Riddle was a wrestler, and if he can stop Brock Lesnar from actually taking him down and sitting on his face and telling him that he loved him, that if Matt Riddle is able to keep it on the feet and starts to hit Brock, Brock's going to fold like my laundry. But what do you think, Bailey?
I would like to think that Brock Lesnar would win, but he sort of got that glass jaw where anything that makes a connection with him, he goes doing cartwheels and pirouettes in the middle of the ring. The poor guy. I really, really admit, what I'm talking about.
No,
when he was fighting Overeem
Brock.
And he started doing breakdancing in the middle of the ring.
No, that was Cain Velasquez when he got.
Oh, Velasquez, yes, I'm sorry.
The one with Overeem is when he got kicked in the itis.
So we've seen a lot of a lot of Lesnar not being able to take some hits. So I mean, you got a striker in Matt Riddle. So I mean, with the right strike, I think Riddle could possibly take him. But I think in reality, if that match ever took place, I think it would be a Brock Lesnar charge at him, and Matt Riddle is crying like a little bitch in the corner. I think really in reality, that's what it would be.
That he would just open field fucking tackle.
Yeah, he would just go for the gears. Don't even give him a chance to go striking and all that stuff and squash his little ass.
You know, it'd be hilarious if he did that, but it ended like Jorge Masvidal and Funky Ben Askren, where Brock Lesnar dives right into a flying knee.
Oh, clink. Out cold.
Have you ever seen that one, Sheehan? That's a
no.
recent fight.
Yeah. Oh wow.
Okay. Well, while I break down Adam Cole versus Tommaso Ciampa, quick Google Jorge Masvidal, Ben Askren, and then take your pants off because you're going to need to. It's that good. All right.
Adam, the fight is 17 seconds?
Yes, sir. Hang on. Wow, hang on. Let's just do a watch-along. Go ahead, Sheen. Hit play.
All right.
There's a guy with cornrows. There's a guy with red shorts.
Oh shit.
Isn't it great?
Why can't all MMA fights be like this? And I'd actually watch it.
We have 20 fights on this next card. It'll be over in 5 minutes.
Right? Sign me up.
You know what? There's no reason that WWE could not pull off something like that. You know what I mean? Just imagine a main event at WrestleMania. I mean, obviously, you'd have to do a little bit of work to it. And it would have to be someone other than Goldberg to get this thing over. But, I mean, just imagine a quick Matt Riddle-Brock Lesnar match for a belt, and Riddle just literally knocks him cold with a knee.
Yeah.
I mean, that the place would come unglued, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
I think if you did it the way they did Seth Rollins, Brock Lesnar last year, that would work. If you end the night...
Seth Rollins. I physically get ill at the mention of his name.
Oh, WrestleMania is going to be fun with you. all right.
The Messiah.
Sorry, it's going to be him against Kevin Owens, like 7 out of 13 falls, I think.
So well, that'll be good, because hopefully it'll be the last match on then, and I can leave early with my kids, who will both be asleep.
They're going to be intermittent. They're going to go every other match. It's going to be great.
I just want to throw up now, not because I coughed hard.
Not once.
All right, Adam Cole defeated Tommaso Ciampa in 9 hours and 107,000 kickouts. I want to say this match was great. It was definitely brutal, and I liked the psychology of Tommaso Ciampa injuring his head and neck, which is what he had surgery on and he was out for so long with. And so they played a lot on that, and, you know, and then Gargano, you know, nothing could finish Ciampa, nothing could finish Cole, nobody interfering could help the matter. They were just fighting forever in an eternal stalemate until Gargano hit Ciampa with the magic belt, and suddenly that did it.
They kicked out of a billion moves, and a minor belt shot knocked him cold.
A weak ass belt shot.
I wish Gargano had said "I love you" when he did it, like Shawn Michaels and Ric Flair.
I'm sorry, I love you.
Yes. That would have been perfect. And there had been a gunshot in the background and the minor howl of a dog. Anyway, on the one hand, good psychology. On the other hand, way too many night. I don't understand how at this point, with AEW out there and as many NXT shows as they've done, why we're going back to the well of 900 kickouts. Is this it? Have we run out of ideas? Is that where we are right now? We're just out of ideas in wrestling, and this is all we can think of for our main event, major match, is have it go north of 20 minutes and have 900 kickouts. I just don't understand, Bailey. Talk to me. Teach me.
You're exactly right. So the NXT formula that has worked up till now has been this formula of everybody kicking out of every match, and they've slowly started to graze their way out of that thing. Take a look at, let's start the, in one of the matches on this particular night where he had the Balor match. They actually hit his finisher and won the match. This one was your traditional NXT takeover match where everybody kicks out of everything. And this one only had a little bit of a twist. So, I mean, outside interference was the call of the day here. I mean, you saw it in the women's match. You saw it in this one. You saw Charlotte interfere. So, I mean, interference was happening all over the place. Did I expect that Johnny Gargano would come out and yet again screw Tommaso Ciampa? I actually didn't, because it was done so many times with these two that I was like, there's absolutely no way they're doing this. And especially when they had the DIY or whatever on the last UK show, that I just thought that, you know, these guys are on the same page for once and, you know, they're going to transition away from it. No, sir. We're right back in the middle of good old Gargano and Ciampa once again. And Cole gets the win. I'm actually mind-boggled that they went in this direction. You talk about a match that has worn out its welcome. I just don't want to see another match with these two. I'm over it and done. Gargano can bring his wife and try to mix the match up. $5 Candice LeRae. There's just nothing left in this at all. I mean, they're back in, you know, Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens territory where, you know, we're friends, we're not friends, or we're bitter enemies, by God. It's done and over with, man. I don't know. But I think we're seeing a big flaw in the NXT booking overall. So I think they've actually let the air out of the room. I think that they're to the point now where they booked themselves in the corner. Their main event scene has weakened substantially. They need something to change it up here now. They've got an influx of new talent, and I think it's time to start shuffling the deck. I'm hopeful that after WrestleMania, a lot of these guys are no longer on this roster.
Yeah, I don't know. It's this is the typical issue with WWE where they... And this goes all the way back to even like the XFL back in, you know, in its initial inception, where I think they think something's a good idea, they go forth with said good idea, but they don't really lay the groundwork for the idea to be successful. So it's like, okay, the USA Network throws retard money at them to get NXT on the USA Network, and they're like, and they go all lizard brain and like, yeah, great idea. Okay, two problems here. One, this was supposed to be your developmental brand so people could get experience working on television and getting used to the grind of working on the road, and this is for them to be learning. And now you've just said they're the third brand. Well, and this has been the theme of the night, right? Many of them don't have the experience to really carry a whole brand. That's why they're not on the main roster.
Exactly.
So you've set people up to fail. And I love NXT, but I love NXT because it's just a wrestling show for people learning how to wrestle who have been able to graduate from the indie scene. And that's what I liked about it.
It's like they're backstage going, we need a great show, guys. What are we going to do? Oh, let's stick Keith Lee and Dominik Dijakovic back in the ring. They're good.
Yeah.
It's the same fucking match every time. It's the same match. And it seems like the, you know, Cole and Ciampa, you could just interchange people, and it's going to be that same match. That's the dilemma that NXT is in. Something in their formula needs to change up to say that it's a, you know, it's a newer, fresher product, because it is literally starting to stagnate.
Ring of Honor and NWA Power have a working agreement.
Yes.
In theory, AEW is working with New Japan, from what I recall. I might be wrong about
and
that.
Somewhat of a little bit of an agreement with Ring of Honor, because we had one of the Ring of Honor guys show up on AEW last week.
Yeah, it was Jeff Cobb. The WWE, MLW is looking for a TV deal. If the WWE were smart, they would extend the WWE network to MLW and start integrating the MLW guys into NXT. Step one.
Well, what I would say is, have you seen MLW, and why in the hell would you want any of that on your TV?
Yes. Yes, I have.
I do not like.
There's some talent there in a lot of the MLW guys ended up in AEW.
Again, my point.
Well, I'm not talking about Orange Cassidy. I'm talking about, like, MJF.
Shout out to Teddy Hart in jail.
Somebody send him bail money. Oh, wait, don't.
Who's going to feed the cat?
Okay, so maybe, look, I like the MLW idea, but Chris Bailey's shitting all over it. So there's other.
They just have no talent left, that's all.
There's 900 other places out there they could. So the second thing I was going to say is NXT needs to go back to the WWE network. And you're like, but retard money. Hang on, let me finish. NXT needs to go on the road. They need to get the USA show out of Full Sail University. You know, you can't be half pregnant. You got to go, you know, really lean into this idea. So if NXT is really your third brand, you need an influx of new halfway television ready talent, and you need to start playing some arenas. As I've said before, and I will keep saying it, and I said this about AEW, but, you know, whatever. There are college campuses with basketball arenas hurting for acts to fill them up when basketball's not happening. Like, the USF Sundome had a Bellator event not that long ago because they desperately needed asses and seats there. And that was like, well, that was like before Scott Coker and all them came over to Bellator. This was like early Bellator. If fucking bare knuckle boxing can find places to, you know, to do their shit, which, by the way, Christian, if you like fight real fighting, but you don't want to waste time watching a whole 15-minute fight, boy, have I got a sport for you. Bare knuckle boxing is the best. And it, their fights are like a minute long, if that.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah. I'll talk to you about that later. Okay. But yeah. But like bare knuckle, where it's licensed. I mean, they played the Florida Fairgrounds like twice, and that's like not a bad place to play. You know, it's a small arena. Like I said, they have the USF Sundome over here. There were like 80 zillion college campuses throughout the United States, and they all have arenas. You know what I mean? So you have a trapped audience who's looking for shit to do. That's why like a lot of universities have. Like a concerts club, like they have a club for students that go that book acts. So it would be easy, I think, to get NXT into places with young hip crowds, and now they're in arenas that look like the AEW show as opposed to this studio show that they've been doing. And the studio show needs to go back to being a place where some of these not yet ready for primetime players can work out their kinks.
Yes, you know what I mean, Sheen? Yes, mm-hmm. All the way yes.
You know what I mean, Sheen?
That's actually exactly what I was... if you didn't get there, I was going to take us there. I think it'd be a really good idea. I mean, they've got how many people under contract right now? Like 70,000? They got so many damn people under contract.
More people they under contract than the population of any small African country.
Sure, I mean, they could... do like a soft split on an NXT roster where they do keep some veterans and some brand new ones doing the studio show and start maybe filtering some of the more experienced newbies up to the main roster that goes on the road. I think that'd be a great transition to get to the main roster eventually. I think the whole thing is that, you know, we've got, they're a legitimate third roster now. They're a third league, and it's what do you do? I mean, you can't take all the top guys and move them up like they used to do. Like, it used to be where, like, NXT would get pillaged, you know, after WrestleMania. Like, the five or six hottest acts in the division would, or in the brand would go up. And then you'd have to rebuild all year, which is kind of what they should be doing. But now, since they're trying to pop a rating, they've got the Wednesday Night War that they're fucking fighting in. They, you know, we gotta keep some recognizable talent on the NXT roster. So it's going to stagnate, and I mean this damn match here is proof positive. It's there's just too damn much. It's they talked about Adam Cole. This is like his like seventh or eighth takeover that he's headlined, and it's like that's too much for a developmental league, you know. When are you gonna be, you know, when is the cake done, you know? If you've been cooking for this damn long and you've been on top of this mountain for that long, where do you go? Where do right. you go from here? And it's like, I feel bad for him because it's like they can't move him up because they need him on NXT, but they can't do anything else with him because he's already done everything on NXT. And it's just such a weird spot to be in. And the formula of the main event, it's like if you ever made the mistake of laughing at a kid's joke, and then, like, the rest of the day, they make the same joke over and over and over again.
Have you met my son?
I've met everybody's son, it seems. It's I'll have, like, my nephew will tell a joke, and I'll laugh, and then he'll just tell the same joke all day long because it made me laugh the first time, and that's what we're getting with these damn Skatey 800 kickout matches here. It's like 40. It happened the one time, and we're like, oh, that's pretty cool. I was invested in that, and it's like, oh, you like that, huh?
40 years ago, my son told a joke about why did the cookie go to the doctor? Because he was feeling very crummy. And we were like, ha, that's really funny, Jonas. And then I heard it every day until I died.
Yep. that's the NXT formula. That's they got it from your son. And it's... They saw that it, you know, it popped us when they did one of these like near fall deals a couple years ago, and then it's like, oh, that you like your medicine here, you're gonna take it. So this is what we get. The turn with Gargano, instead of it being like a, oh wow, Johnny turned heel, it's like, oh, he did that again.
Exactly, because they wasted the bloom off the rose.
Exactly. He was there's a law of diminishing returns here, and they turned him heel against friggin' Aleister Black like a year ago. Not even. And that went nowhere, and then all of a sudden he's a babyface again for no reason. You know, I don't think, did they ever give a reason why Johnny was a good guy again? Or did he just come out as a good guy? I don't recall them ever actually turning him back babyface. But all the oomph was off of this heel turn, because we've already seen it. It's not a big deal anymore. And this is like when TNA was like teeter-tottering, turning Sting heel. And it's like, well, you know, now we've seen it a few times. It's not like the big first big heel turn. It's just another heel turn. And just like you guys, I really don't need to see another Tommaso and Johnny match. I don't need to see them. I don't need to see them get personal. I don't need to see $5 Candace get involved. I thought the feud that they did have, though endless, was really good while it was going on. Some real hate filled feuding, and I mean, that wasn't too long ago. I don't know that you can revisit it this soon. It just feels
And they kept redeeming Ciampa, so you know what I mean? Yeah. Like they set us up, he became the biggest heel in the entire company for NXT. Yeah. And I mean, he was irredeemable. And then they redeemed him. So at that point, that's when your storyline ends.
Even Moro and Beth, and they're talking about his kid. I mean, this is the psycho killer. I don't want to hear about his kid. I don't want to hear him telling. I don't want to hear about him singing to his kid at night. I don't want to know his kid's name. I don't want to know that he has a kid. Right, he's the psycho killer.
Right. That was my favorite part of the Nightmare on Elm Street series, is when you got to meet Freddy's family.
Yeah, they were great.
Yes, exactly. He's a well-adjusted kid, that Freddy.
Yeah, it's like they've got him. They've got the crowd singing along to his music when he used to come out to None, which was great. I mean, it's just they've turned. I don't know how you can be sympathetic towards a psycho killer, but they're gonna try. Damn it, they're gonna try.
Yeah, NXT has outgrown Full Sail University, and it really. I mean, like, and I know if you know, once I say this, you're gonna be like, wow, that carries a lot of negative connotation, but the idea was sound. It just was not executed well, as many things are, and I've noticed. But ECW was supposed to be its own third brand, and they tried, god damn it.
They did, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They tried to give them their own shows, they gave them their own pay-per-view, and, you know, it just, nothing worked out. There was a lot that went wrong there.
Pregnant.
Yeah. Here, they did it right. You know, they built up the studio show. It was kind of like how Raw started off. You know, Raw started off in just the Manhattan Center, and they were taping every other week, and...
Yep.
You know, it was something like an hour, and then it built up to 2 hours, and then it became, you know, and then they outgrew the Manhattan Center, and wrestling started to pick up again, so they started going to basketball and hockey arenas again, you know, and then the product died. I may have skipped a chapter or two, but...
Hey, you could make a WWE Network documentary then.
Wow, that Ruthless Aggression documentary was fucking trash.
I haven't seen it yet. I can't wait.
We got the F out because we needed a jump start. That's all.
We just needed a fresh coat of paint. Yeah, World Wildlife Fund.
Yeah. Nothing to do with the fucking panda.
Nothing at all. It was like, you're being sued. I don't understand who Sue is. The invasion didn't go over very well because none of these guys could believably beat Stone Cold. I fucking hate every one of you. it's just awful. Anyway, I could go. We could spend another hour talking about how much I hated that Ruthless Aggression thing, and I will probably not watch
it. It was terrible.
The Monday Night War, the documentary series, didn't bother me as much. You know, I was like, eh, it's fine. I know it's a revisionist history, but it wasn't outright lies like Ruthless Aggression was.
Yeah.
Anyway. Bailey, anything else about Cole versus Ciampa? I think we've covered this. One thing I'm going to throw out there, and then I'll let you have the last word. What if the main event of NXT Tampa in April is an Elimination Chamber with Cole, Ciampa, Balor, Gargano, and
Angel Garza.
Shut up. just for shits and giggles, let's say, you know,
Velveteen.
Velveteen.
Oh, don't listen. I'm so over Velveteen Dream. I just don't want to see it anymore. The gimmick has burned out on me.
You know what? I like this idea. Throw Dream in there, but also throw what's his nuts?
Roderick
Strong. You know, and so you know, what if we did those six guys?
The hell with it. Why not? It's something different. Do it.
There's a lack of Angel Garza in there, but I can do it.
For you, Sheehan, this is for you.
Okay.
The sound of beating a dead horse.
but he won the NXT All Out tournament or whatever, right?
No, that was what's his face who then
Angel Garza.
They made a racist T-shirt and then he quit.
They made a racist T-shirt about Angel Garza.
So next week. I'll make the jokes around here, sir. All right, our next wrestling show will be Sunday, March 1st. We're going to give you a double shot. We'll have one show entirely dedicated to WWE Blood Money 2020, otherwise known as the Super Showdown, where, once again, the interns at the WWE were listening. I said on Twitter, Goldberg versus The Fiend. And guess what's headlining the show? Who's smarter? Who's the smart? I am.
It's you.
I'm a smart.
Who's winning? Predictions.
I hope Goldberg, and I hope it's like 30 seconds.
Me.
I hope so.
I hope he just like fucking spears him right on the ramp.
Yeah, you know? Right down through that fucking hole.
Just fucking spears somebody, all you hear is, ah-wee! Goldberg crawls out with that stupid belt. It'd be great. So we'll dedicate one entire TV party to Super Showdown. We'll take a pause for the cause, and we'll come back, and we'll give you another show dedicated to AEW Revolution Demox, which rhymes with Delox, versus Chris Jericho of the Inner Circle. What do you think about that, Bailey?
Oh boy, I really don't know what to think. I'm just looking forward to something different, something with a little bit of flair. I love these overseas shows and all that type of stuff. So you know, I'm just hoping that all these companies, all these brands, have something different in mind, because every single brand right now is in a period of staleness. So we need some PECO electric shock to the gut to get us back in action here. Mix it up.
Well, Brock Lesnar versus Ricochet, and I think the finish of that match is going to be Ricochet will lose when Brock Lesnar punches him in the anus.
Oh, watch your ass, Brock.
That's his power move, though. I think that might actually like be like that resurrection elbow that Savage gave Hogan that one time.
Oh, that's right. I love that. That was
awesome. I think you punch Ricochet there, he's going to be okay.
Punch Ricochet right in the anus, and he becomes Super Ricochet.
He does.
I love it.
<He's> perfect.
Erectus menace.
Jokes, everybody. And speaking of Elimination Chambers, we'll cover that show for you on Wednesday, March 11th. So you can look for those.
Do me a favor. I want to try something before we go.
Yes, sir.
I have the NXT roster up here, okay? Just for the men.
Sure.
Yes. I'm going to split it right down the middle, half for Mark, half for Chris.
Okay.
And I want you to – I'm going to spit out a name, and I want you just to – the first thing that rolls off the top of your head, and we'll do this really fast, okay?
Okay, so we're doing word association.
Word association. So we're going to go Adam Cole to Kushida for Mark. Ready? Let's roll. Adam Cole.
Bebe.
Angel Garza.
Stop.
Boa.
Constrictor.
Bobby Fish.
Fish fry.
Exactly. Cameron Grimes.
Hat. The true knot.
Caesar Bononi.
My baloney.
Damian Priest.
Archer Fire Guy.
Danny Burch.
Tree?
Dominic Dijakovic.
Oh, my man.
Fandango.
Dances.
Finn Balor.
Twink.
Isaiah Swerve Scott.
Fast forward.
I'm gonna do this one personally. Jackson Riker, steroids. Okay. Johnny Gargano.
Barry Horowitz.
Cassius Ohno.
Oh no.
Keith Lee.
It's fine.
Killian Dane.
Fat.
Kona Reeves.
Crush.
Oh, gross. Terrible. And Kushida.
Japanese.
All right, cool. Sheen, ready to rock?
Let's do it.
All right, Kyle O'Reilly.
Guitar banger.
There you go. Leo Rush.
What did he say about Bobby Lashley? We all love Bobby, or was that the president? Somebody said that.
Bob Lashley. Mansoor.
Isn't he a neo-Nazi now? Isn't that the joke?
Shocking. Terrible. Matt Riddle.
Bruh.
Oney Lorcan.
That name sounds like he should be a sea creature.
Raul Mendoza.
Who?
Exactly. Roderick Strong.
Looks a lot like Mauro Ranallo's brother.
Shane Thorne.
Who?
Exactly. Tommaso Ciampa.
Used to be the guy.
Tyler Breeze.
He's there?
Exactly. Velveteen Dream.
Getting old.
And speaking of, is he still there? Wesley Blake.
That's the other Murphy?
Isn't that the guy who was he the one going out with Alexa Bliss?
I think it was Murphy who was.
Oh, okay. So Wesley Blake was just a guy who watched, so he was like doing the
he was the cameraman.
Xavier Woods position. Anyway, that's it, folks.
Ew.
Thank you for indulging me on that. Fun times.
I think this is a lot about the NXT roster, don't you?
That's what I was trying to get at. We talked about the roster and going through those names. It's pretty scary.
Yeah. So speaking of scary, in the meantime, so that's all the wrestling coverage. If you're looking for what's going on this week, Jesse and I did our coverage of Sonic Genesis, the 4-part+2 series in the old Sonic the Hedgehog comic book. Where
I loved it. It was good.
Oh, you listened to it?
Yep, I certainly did.
I like Jesse. He's like, hey, have you been playing much Sonic Mania? No, I don't play that shit.
Poor Jesse. He's just like the ah shucks good guy, and he's got like the super heel with him all the time with you. It's a sin.
We are definitely Gorilla and Jesse Ventura.
Oh, absolutely. 100%.
So speaking of me and Jesse, tomorrow we'll be reviewing the Hollywood Undead New Empire Volume 1, and then wrestling takes precedence over movies. We kicked Damn You Hollywood over to Thursday this week. We'll be reviewing the new record-breaking Sonic the Hedgehog movie. Friday night, myself, John Warren, and Pat Mullen will be doing a preview of Wilder Fury 2, and neither one of them will be doing coverage with me on Saturday night. That'll most likely be myself and Robert Winfrey, or it'll just be me sobbing through that fight, because no one will play with me. I'm so lonely. Speaking of lonely, last week was dedicated to Harley Quinn and the Birds of Prey. Ugh. Birds of Prey, Harley Quinn, however you like it. We covered the comic book that was slapped together. We covered the movie that was a pile of trash.
Does she lick her teeth a lot in that? Because I think that's all she did in the other movie. Every time the commercial was on, she was licking her damn teeth. That was it.
Pat and I did the next chapter in the boxing history. We did Floyd Patterson and Sonny Liston. Sonny Liston is the devil. we reviewed Sepultura Quadra, and then Alexis, Haina, and I covered the TV party for Birds of Prey, which apparently we cracked up Chris Bailey, so that's good.
Oh, really, really strong, man. That was good stuff.
I'm glad you enjoyed it. And then I think... Oh, yeah. Friday night, myself and Robert Winfrey covered all 1 minute of... Sheehan, while we're finishing up plugs here, quick Google Ryan Garcia versus Francisco Fonseca. Yeah.
See, highlights. 17 minutes?
No. Just see if you can find the fight. It won't take you long. So we covered that. And then because that ended the way that it did, we also covered the St. Valentine's Day Massacre over on Showtime. Thomas Matisse versus Isaac Cruz, which was a fun fight to watch. An upset. As the B-side of that one, it was Isaac Cruz. And then myself and John Ward covered the Fox fight from this past weekend, the giant marketing event for Wilder Fury 2. Caleb Plant versus my new favorite fighter, Vincent Feigenbutz. Feigenbutz, Chris Bailey. Let's get the Feigenbutz out of here.
Yeah, absolutely, brother.
All right. Chris, where can they find you?
They can find me over on the Twitter at Charlton_hero. And listen, I'm not even going to plug my own stuff. You guys need to go and check out the Birds of Prey coverage with Alexis, Mark, and who else was with you?
On the movie review, the new one?
Yeah.
That was David Wright and Robert.
Oh, so good. Hilarious at all costs. So just forget me and just go listen to that.
Well, thank you. Sheehan, if you find it after we're done, you have to like text me or whatever. But go ahead and plug your stuff, buddy.
You can find me every day at chrisisoninfiniteearths.com, at least for the next little while. I'm reviewing different DC stories every day. I've been doing it every day for 4 years. Hopefully, eventually, I'll start recording my voice on stuff again. Not that it's terribly in demand, but it was something I enjoyed doing at one time, and hopefully, I will again real soon. You can find that. Hopefully at chrisandreggie.com. I got to make sure our payment goes through to make sure we're still rolling, or else it'll be somewhere else. Who knows?
All right, folks. Thank you for listening to this TV Party Tonight coverage of NXT TakeOver Portland. For the podsmen who have ridden again, be well, be safe, and behave.